How could anyone forget that? To the world, it looked like I had my life all together. Inside, I was a mess of pride and fear and anger. I tried a lot of bad stuff, thinking it would make me feel better about who I was, or that it would distract me from the fear I fought every day, or that it would quiet the rage in my heart. None of it worked for long, but a friend introduced me to Jesus and said, "Jesus can help you. Trust him." And that's what I did. I just trusted that this one who said he loved me and had the power to change me and had the grace to forgive me would do all of it.
I had been his follower for a long time. I had known him as my savior and my friend. Then I was diagnosed with cancer. Suddenly, everything I had believed about him was tested. Throughout the months of chemotherapy, surgery, and radiation, he was my provider, my healer, my everything. In the hardest moments, in the uncertainty of the long nights, in the face of fear, I would speak his name, Jesus, and he was always there.
Through our darkness, light. simply invisible to the world. On the worst, I was despised and shamed. Do you know what it's like to live without ever being touched by someone who cares about you? I was lied to and abused, but I was never heard or cared for. Jesus changed all that. He loved me, and I loved him because I deserved absolutely nothing, and he gave me everything.
Ashamed of what I've done, what I've become. These hands are dirty, I dare not lift them up to the Holy One. You plead my cause, you right my wrongs, you break my chains, you overcome, you gave me life to give me mine, you say that I am free. How can that be? Inside, I doubt that you still love me, but in your eyes there's only grace now.
I talked a big game. Even the name Jesus gave me, Peter, meant the rock. I loved Jesus, and I believed in everything he said and all he did. I really believed I would follow him into any battle, even to death. but I didn't expect it to go down the way it did in Gethsemane the night he was arrested. I tried to defend him, but he stopped me. He didn't fight. He surrendered. It shook me, and as I watched the soldiers, the mob, the Romans, I panicked. And then I denied I even knew him. The memory still hurts, but he forgave even that. He forgave, and he didn't stop loving me.
About his resurrection, it sounds impossible and crazy. Yet you trust and you hope and you imagine it over and over. That's what it was for me. But until death crashes into your world, until you're the one making funeral plans for someone who meant the world to you, until you're the one walking away from a grave and headed home to an empty place at the table, you don't know what you really believe. You find out, though. There were moments his spirit was like a tender anointing. I was held by mercy and overwhelmed by his love. He was real, and I knew that what I had believed in faith about his death and his resurrection was true.
Thank you. was nothing to me. Overseeing his crucifixion was just another day on the job. I helped drive him up the hill, made sure the nails in his hands and feet would hold the weight of his body, kept the crowd under control, and was unmoved by his groans of pain. I was close enough to hear him when he spoke of hope to a man suffering next to him. And when he spoke lovingly to his mother and a friend, and when he asked his father to forgive those who were crucifying him, that was me. He was forgiving me while I was in the middle of torturing him. And then he asked why God had left him totally alone to bear it all. By the time even I was anxious for the end of it to his agony, he cried with a loud voice, "It is finished." And it was like someone turned off the lights on that hill. The ground shook, the sky disappeared. Even in the darkness, suddenly I could see he was no ordinary man. The truth came like a bolt of lightning. This was the Son of God.
You have made a place. Years after I met him, I wrote, "While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." That was my story. He died for me while I thought I was too smart to believe, too pure to need his forgiveness, too proud to humble myself to him, too strong to admit I needed him. The road to Damascus changed everything. He was alive, and because he was alive, I couldn't deny him. He had me, and I found that surrendering to him was joy and freedom.
Because he's alive, no matter who I was, no matter what I've done, there's a place for me in his kingdom.
Because he's alive, I'm not broken and thrown away. I am valued and whole.
Because he's alive, I can be forgiven for my crimes, even my part in his death.
Because he's alive, death is not the end. I will see my loved one again.
Because he's alive, my failures are not my destiny. His strength is my courage. His love is my hope.
Because he's alive, the healing I've known here is only a glimmer of the ultimate healing I will know in his presence.
Because he's alive, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Mm-hmm.